everyone, it's Jack from Cultaholic.com here in a very traditional Japanese setting. We're sat on the floor, it's all good. And I'm joined by the one and only Rocky Romero. How are you?
I'm good. I'm a little uncomfortable because we're on tatami mats, but I'm comfortable.
What are they called? Sorry.
Tatami mats.
Yeah, they're quite thin.
Yeah. I gave myself like three pillows.
You've got a few. I've got one.
Yeah, you have one.
Never mind. now, you are now kind of, you're a regular kind of veteran figure, I suppose, in the New Japan scene. Mm-hmm. What do you make of this past sort of week at Wrestle Kingdom, New Year Dash? It's all been going on. Do you think it's been good? I've thought it's been fantastic, but what did you make of it?
I think it's been very successful. Obviously, we had a record crowd,
yes,
for us of like 38,000 plus, which is a huge deal for us. We're up like 4,000 or so more than last year. New Year's Dash was insane. Then all the announcements, we're going to London, mm-hmm, on August 31st. We're going to be in America July 6th for the opening of the G1,
yes,
which is crazy. First time ever that's been done outside of Japan. Mm-hmm. And then the huge announcement of Double Dome.
2 days.
2 days.
So I got a bit confused. I've seen conflicting takes on this from people online.
Okay.
Some people seem to think it's a 2-day Wrestle Kingdom. Others have said New Year's Dash is moving to the Dome. Can you confirm or deny which one of those it is?
I can neither confirm nor deny because I have no idea.
Well, either way, it represents, I guess, a real growth in stature for not just New Japan, but for Wrestle Kingdom necessarily, but Wrestle Kingdom time of year.
Right. I feel like it really showed this year that the Wrestle Kingdom week is now becoming like similar to like a WrestleMania, where not only is New Japan and then maybe a couple of Japanese promotions, but now we had Fight Club Pro coming over to Korakuen and running a show a couple days after. And now it's like, now this is becoming a thing. Because we're doing Double Domes 2 days in a row, I imagine that there's going to be all kinds of other promotions coming from all over the world, in Korakuen and Shinkiba, and they're all, this is going to be probably right now, the second biggest week of the year in professional wrestling.
Right, it's more of an event. It's not just about the event itself. It's more of a festival.
And it's a festival. It's a celebration of professional wrestling in general, which is cool. And us New Japan wrestlers and the staff who worked super hard to get these shows up and going for your entertainment, everybody. We just can't thank you enough for all the like love and support. And, we're just going to keep trying hard and bring it every night.
Excellent. Now, of course, your predominant role right now on camera in New Japan is as the manager, sometimes tag partner, of Roppongi 3K, Sho and Yo. What do you make of those guys' developments in the past sort of year or two? Because they're still relatively new guys on the full-time New Japan roster.
Right. I think you haven't really seen everything that they can do yet, because we really haven't seen them in like singles competition. We saw them in the Best of Super Junior last year, and you kind of saw a touch of that. But they're developing at such a rapid rate. It's pretty incredible. And it's so cool to see the following grow. Like, maybe you guys obviously didn't see it too much this week. But, like, when we go and we do autograph signings, there's about 250 girls that come
to the signings.
And it's pretty cool. They actually have become, like, a Japanese idol.
They're like the Rockers.
Yeah, they're like the Rockers, but like a true sense of that Japanese idol like group.
Right.
But with those two guys and in professional wrestling, which is kind of rare.
Right. There's kind of a crossover there between the two forms of entertainment.
And there's a lot of fans that they're not really into professional wrestling necessarily, but they come and they like to watch just that.
Right.
So wink, wink.
That's cool. One thing we did experience, though, was both Wrestle Kingdom and New Year's Dash as well, was how hyped the crowd get for the entrance, because entrances, I guess, in New Japan aren't necessarily as loud sometimes as in Western wrestling.
Right.
But we did see some examples. One of those, I guess, was Roppongi 3K. Now, the theme tune, I imagine, has something to do with you, because that's your voice rapping it as well.
Yeah, that's my voice. I rap it, and I created the beat and
that's
everything.
I did
everything myself, and with a friend of mine who's a rapper and producer. His name is The Ashoka. You can check him out. He helped me to record it and do everything. And that's what I've done for the last few years is make music on my laptop, and I did it with Forever Hooligans, I did it with Roppongi Vice.
I was going to say, you did it for Roppongi Vice. So have you been into music as long as you've been into wrestling?
Yeah, but that musical part didn't really develop until a bit later in my wrestling career.
Okay.
Like I did like choir and stuff when I was a kid, and I was like wrote songs. I was in a couple of bands, but kind of that all went away because I wanted to put all my focus into professional wrestling. But I was living in Mexico at the time, and I was working for a company called AAA, and I wasn't very happy. So I would feel like I wasn't getting my creative outlet like kind of going. So I just picked up a laptop, cheap laptop. I stole Fruity Loops, please don't sue me, Fruity Loops, FL Studio, and then I just started making beats and writing songs, and it just took off from there.
Excellent stuff.
Yeah.
I guess it gives it a certain edge that not many other people have as well in the wrestling
right,
business.
Right, right. And for me, I was thinking like, oh, this is like a promotional piece, this is like, I can use it as merchandise, and it's like, it's me. It's a part of my character, it's a part of the connection to the people, so.
Cool. Before Roppongi 3K, of course, you were in a tag team with Beretta.
Right.
I nearly called him Trent Beretta, but he's just...
Or just Beretta, Beretta. Maybe question mark sometimes.
Yes, or right. Trenty Locks on Twitter as well.
now, change that handle already, Trent, sorry.
Now, I was personally quite sad initially when you guys broke up. I really enjoyed the tag team. I enjoyed the dynamic. But seeing how both you guys have gone since, you're with Roppongi 3K, he's now with his best friend, Chucky T, but things aren't going quite so well there. It seems to be a bit strange.
I feel like I'm the better best friend, don't you?
Right. Well, you certainly never got any matches thrown out, hitting anybody with chairs or anything like that.
I was in it to win it for sure.
Right, yeah. Right. What do you make of Beretta's progression so far since leaving the team?
You know, he had such a great end of the year in 2017.
Right.
He faced Kenny Omega. He had a great match with him in Osaka. And then I think 2018 looked to be pretty huge for him. But unfortunately, he got injured. Yeah. And that kind of messed his whole kind of year up, you know. So I'm curious to see what happens in 2019 because obviously, you know, he looks great. He's in great shape. He's shown these great moments of brilliance. Mm. So I think now it's got to be his breakout kind of year. This is the time to kind of do it. So hopefully 2019 is that time.
Cool. And also, he's got a very supportive mother. She was there in the crowd as well.
Yeah,
it was
awesome to see. Came. She gave him a hug. Yeah,
Sue was great.
Sue was cool. Shout out to Sue. Hey, Sue.
Hey, Sue. so, yeah, that's all really cool. Excuse me, I'm a little bit... We've had one or two drinks. Not too many, but I'm feeling it a little bit right now. Also, I believe you want to give a shout out to a certain Mexican friend of yours.
Yeah, Mr. Chico El Luchador. You can... I'm kind of run his merchandise website.
Yeah.
I'm just so fortunate that I get to run the merchandise of the greatest professional wrestler of all time.
It's so gracious of him to let you do that as well.
Yeah, I pay him 125% on everything, but it's all good. Mr. Chico, shout out to you. You can find the merchandise on RockyRomeroMerch.com. But check out ChicoElLuchador.com to watch his award-winning documentary.
Oh.
And I hear episode 3 is coming soon.
Excellent stuff. Finally, as well, I wanted to ask you generally about New Japan. What do you foresee in the next year or two? Where is the promotion going to go? Because we feel like we're at a bit of a key stage right now, a bit of a crossroads. What can you see going on in the future?
Yeah, definitely no denying that we are probably in the most important year of New Japan, and there's obviously a lot of stuff going on. But I think that this year will be the make or break for New Japan.
Right.
Internationally, I think Japan is always going to be great. We're doing so good here. The business is high. But now it's time to prove ourselves to the world, to show that the New Japan product itself is the best professional wrestling product, bar none.
Right, cool.
So we will do that. Coming to London, like I said, August 31st. Yep. That's going to be huge. The Copper Box, those shows in America. I mean, we hope to go to, you know, New Zealand, Australia, Canada. I mean, you never know, right?
Cool. I guess if I can just squeeze one final question as well.
Sure.
You do quite a lot of commentary these days, too. Mm-hmm. How do you find that? Because I've always been quite interested. How different is that a challenge to being an in-ring performer? How different is that being on commentary?
Right. I mean, at first it was absolutely terrifying.
Right.
To talk for 3 hours.
Yeah.
But, you know, Kevin Kelly is probably one of the most amazing play-by-play guys in the business of all time.
Yeah.
So he kind of like took my hand and kind of, you know, guided me through the whole thing. And then I really started to feel my rhythm and my chemistry with him during the G1 this last year. And, you know, doing 20-something shows in 30 days, that's like, you know, you got to either be good or you got to suck.
You're in the deep end there.
So, but I feel really good about it now. And the outpour from all the wrestling fans worldwide just supporting us, and everything has been great. And I can't thank Kevin enough and New Japan for the experience, and then everybody watching at home on NJPW World.com.
Just as long as you don't root too hard for the Chaos guys, we should all be...
I mean, I have to.
A little bit, yeah.
A little bit. And I don't like Bushi. Everybody knows that. But it's like, you know, it's, you just try to have fun while you're out there. Yeah. And I, like, sometimes I feel like it's almost like a podcast a bit between me and Kevin in a way. Like, because, you know, we do joke around, especially in the early matches. And then when the stuff gets serious and the title matches come on, you know, you're just, I'm just talking from the heart as a fan and a lover of New Japan professional wrestling that... It just comes out, you know?
Excellent. Well, that was my final question. Rocky Romero, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you for your time and having me.
Thank you for making your debut on Cultaholic. I've been Jack. You can follow me on Twitter if you want to, at Jack the Jobber. If you want to plug your own...
At Azuka Rock, AZUCARROC. You can find me on Twitter, Instagram, ChicoElLuchador.com, RockyRomeroMerch.com. That's all I got.
Okay. you can find us as well on Patreon, patreon.com/cultaholic. And never forget, of course, if you haven't done so already, to hit subscribe and to join us. We'll be right back.